Thank you. What better accompaniment than the 6 o'clock bells on the tower? It's 6 o'clock. Thank you again for coming to the third of our meetings. You will see that we have a somewhat different setup this evening. We have yet to find the perfect setup, and I doubt this is it, but we are experimenting. Just so you understand how this is arranged, the working group members are over here on my right, and you will have microphones in each row at some point. The community that is representative of maritime activities on the port, people active in maritime activities on the port who've been invited to join us, are sitting over here on my left. And our valued audience and advisory committee members is sitting in the usual space in the back. So that is the way in which this place is organized for tonight. My guess is that next week, next month, we will be back in the same organization that we usually have. This is necessitated, incidentally, by the number of people that we have here tonight who are both on panels and as resource people, which is why we had to come up with this oddity of a arrangement. Before we start, I want to apologize for something that I've been remiss in doing the last few meetings we have, and that is to acknowledge the presence of members of our advisory committees. We have many advisory committees, as you know. Many of them have been good enough to attend these meetings, but we have never recognized them. So I want to say to those of you who serve in advisory committees that are in the audience, thank you for coming, and I hope that you have an opportunity to participate with us as the meeting goes on. Thank you again for being with us and being on the advisory committees. Thank you. And before we begin the process of the meeting, I would like to introduce the newly elected president of the chair. President? Is it president? Chair? Chair? President of the Port Commission? President, the newly elected president of the Port Commission, Mr. Willie Adams, and we're delighted to have you with us and have the mic.
First of all, it's an honor to be here. Before I get started, I'd just like to say that I want to assure everyone that's here, you know, that the port, we're going through a transition of Monique Moyer leaving, and I just want you to know that the port is in good hands. Our mission statement is we will continue to move forward, and I just wanted
a little bit about me real briefly. I'm a 37-year member of the International Longshoremen Warehouse out of Tacoma, Washington. I've been to ports in 40 countries. We represent all the 29 West Coast ports. That includes Alaska, Hawaii, and also now the Panama Canal. So maritime is what I've been doing for 37 years of my life. I live it, breathe it every day, and the importance. I remember when 9/11 happened, we had to go to Washington, D.C. And I met at the time Secretary of Transportation, Norman Mineta. And his exact words were to us and to the East Coast longshoremen that if there were any threats, they would shut down all the ports in the United States. In saying that, what I'm getting at is if something was to happen, like in the Port of Oakland or Los Angeles, port like San Francisco, Stockton, Sacramento are vital for cargo to have to continue to move. You can't stop the lifeblood of the economy. Since I've been on the Port Commission for the last 3 years, I've been traveling with Peter Daly and others. It's maritime, at one time, in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s, probably all the way up to the 80s, the Port of San Francisco was the largest port that had maritime up and down the West Coast. But as we know now, LA Long Beach is the largest port in the United States. And so somebody made a decision that they wanted to have a port with maritime, real estate, restaurants, shops,
developments. And so the Port of San Francisco is unique compared to the Port of Oakland. The Port of Oakland is containers mostly, but the Port of San Francisco, our maritime now, consists of cruise ships. And one of my goals as a commissioner is that to get up to over 1 million passengers a year. We have over 30 million tourists a year that come to San Francisco, and it's nothing greater. And if you're on a cruise ship, if you had a choice in getting off in Los Angeles or getting off in San Francisco, hands down, San Francisco is the shining star. Also, we have the shipyards, and that employs close to 700-800 people, a lot of cruise ships, and a lot of ships that need repairs. So maritime is very vital. But Pier 80 is a pier that I want to talk about, because in our travels to China and to the Philippines, Peter's been to Europe, we have been actively seeking to bring more maritime to the port. More maritime is a stability for the port, and the port is going to have all the other commodities that it has, but maritime is vital. And we don't have the luxury of Seattle has, or Portland has, or as Oakland has, because all three of those ports I just mentioned, they have the port and the airport, so they get revenue from both. The revenue that we get comes exactly from the Port of San Francisco. There's a deal called the Harbor Maintenance Fund, which is about $60 billion in the Harbor Maintenance Fund. And a part of my job as the Secretary Treasurer of the West Coast, I spend so much time in Washington, D.C., lobbying on behalf of our union, but working with all 12 of the West Coast senators, Senator Schatz and Arono from Hawaii, Senator Boxer from California, Senator Merkley and Wyden from Oregon, Senator Murray and Cantwell from Washington, and then from Alaska, Senator Murkowski and Senator Sullivan, some Democrats, some Republicans. Maritime is bipartisan, and that's how we have to look at it. And as we see the economy growing here in San Francisco, it's not since the gold rush days that we've had a booming economy like we have today. This is the second coming. And a lot of you have lived here for way more time than I've only lived here for 13 years. But you have seen the renaissance of the Port of San Francisco. And a lot of our citizens in San Francisco don't even know that it's a port. John Gollinger comes out a lot and he talks about that the Port of San Francisco is for every citizen. He's right about that. It doesn't matter whether you have money or not. And we have to continue to grow on this port. And I think as we have the giants, as we have developments, as we have the exploratorium, as we have the cruise ship terminal, and other business opportunities that come to San Francisco, you never put all your eggs in one basket. We need to continue to put money and invest into our maritime. And in that Harbor Maintenance Fund, what I find very striking is it's close to $60 billion that West Coast revenue goes into that fund, but all the East Coast ports are getting that money, whether it's Savannah or Charleston. And what has happened, because unfortunately our politicians in Washington, D.C., it doesn't matter what side of the aisle they're on, they're out of touch. They can't seem to get things done, which is not good. They're ineffective. And I don't think they understand the importance of ports. I think you might have heard President Obama in the State of the Union address mention ports twice. And you know, they have a ports caucus that was headed up by Janice Hahn out of Southern California and Ted Poe out of Texas. It's bipartisan, Democrats and Republicans, because they understand the importance of our ports. We have to take that land that we have here and we have to build upon it. And getting money out of that Harbor Maintenance Fund, what has happened is a lot of the politicians will go to the president and say, I tell you what, if you want this or that, I will give you money for Charleston, or I'll give you money for Savannah. And what I think is important is that we tap into that money that pays taxes to uplift our ports. China spends more money in 1 month on infrastructure than we do all year. And if you look at our ports, it would take over $1 billion to bring all our peers up to standards. And that's where they need to be. We have to be competitive. I have a feeling that once you lose any discretionary cargo, you never get it back. So we have to invest in our ports, Pier 80, Pier 96. We have to use that to the maximum. It creates local hire and it creates jobs. I believe that we ought to provide jobs for our community, and that's what Maritime provides. It gives us a cushion. Our portfolio at the port has got to be 9, 10, 11 different commodities. So if one's down, the other one will offset it. So coming here today, I wanted to tell you that I am committed as president and as I've been a commissioner to continue to travel, to work, to sit down with customers, to sit down with the industry, to build up our maritime here in San Francisco. We can do it. There are customers and there are people that are looking at our port. San Francisco has the Midas touch. For some reason, people look at us and they see a port that's a shining star. And we have moved beyond the pale and we can accomplish some good things. So tonight, I just want to tell the working group, thank you, and I will try to answer any questions. But I'm very frank when I talk. I'm not a politician. I'm not a bureaucrat. I'm a working class guy, and I make no apologies for that. I'm a member of the Longshoremen Union, which is one of the most militant and powerful unions in the United States. But we know, as a labor workforce, we offer our labor. And we're the best workforce. We work with our employers. We have a great working relationship with the Port of San Francisco. We have a great working relationship with our employers. At times, is it strained? Sometimes it gets a strain. Sometimes family members don't always agree. But at the end of the day, we are committed to having a working relationship that takes the economy of San Francisco further. Because I go beyond just looking at the Port of San Francisco. I look forward to the Port of San Francisco and Oakland working more closely together and looking at it as a regional area. We can't look at it no more as just San Francisco. We're a region. We're beyond that. We've outgrown that. San Francisco is huge. We just had a Super Bowl here. Oakland doesn't have a cruise terminal. We have that. We have a lot of natural resources. We have great parks. We have developments that are coming in. We have a winning baseball team in the Giants. We have a state-of-the-art exploratorium and a cruise terminal. So I ask that you join with us, get behind our efforts to develop more maritime here in the Port of San Francisco. And as we collectively move forward, we will work together as a group and working with Mayor Ad and the Department of Transportation, Secretary Fox, there are a lot of grants that we can be applying for back in Washington, billions and billions of dollars of grants, whether it's for dredging or for infrastructure on these piers that are falling into the bay. We cannot allow that to happen to our city. We are a world-class city. We have to have our piers, and we have to have the infrastructure that we vitally need to compete. It was funny when I went to China with Peter, and Peter would tell you this. We went to China, and we went to a break bulk terminal, and they said to us, next time you come here, this will be completed. We went 2 years later. It's the largest break bulk terminal in the world. They didn't do a lot of talking. They got it done. And what's happening for us in Washington, D.C., and a lot of times is these politicians do a lot of talking back in Washington. They're not getting it done, and that's on both sides of the aisle. And the Department of Transportation and others have to look out of the needs of the Port of San Francisco and all these ports, because the lifeblood of our economy flows through our 29 West Coast ports. When you're talking about $2 trillion a year going through your West Coast ports, that is a lot of money, that is a lot of power, that's a lot of infrastructure, and at the end of the day, you're talking close to 17 million jobs that are associated with our waterfront nationally. It is a national treasure, so I ask to get up, talk, engage us. We want to know, and I believe in being a problem solver. You may not agree with everything that I say. I may not agree with everything you say, but I will tell you something. I am committed, and I am up front, and I am always frank with people. I don't lie to them. I'll tell you to your face what I think. But I care about the Port of San Francisco, and I want to see it grow, and I am committed, and so is my commissioners, and so is the fine staff that work daily, day in and day out to make this a great port. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. We're going to take a minute to let people find their seats, and perhaps somebody can come up here and fix my mic for me. That would be helpful, too. If there's a mic technician around, that would be nice. If you could, if members of the working group can find a spot, I think there's still chairs. Okay, good. Okay, let me then, if I may, tell you about very quickly about the process for this evening. The discussion of maritime activities will be led by the maritime director of the port, Peter Daly, who's sitting on my left. There will be a series of presentations. And we will, after each presentation, we will ask for questions. Again, as is usual, we will either Janice, the co-chair of the committee, or I will recognize people. The questions should come after you've been recognized, and Peter will then direct them to the person who is most qualified to respond to you. But it would be, as we have done in the past, to assure concision and equity, we ask that you address your questions to either Janice or I, and we'll recognize you after you've been recognized by one of us. Remember, our commitments are to civility and to an orderly civil process, which I hope will continue to be the case. I'm sure it will be. And we need to go on to the first action item of the evening, which is the acceptance of the meeting notes, which were sent to you in the package. I think you all have those. And let me just say, with respect to those, I think it's important that you read them, that you make sure that they are fully representative of what was said. Because when we approach the substantive discussions we will have, a year from now, that will be the only record we have, unless we can view film of what was said. So we, it's very hard to imagine that all of you will commit to memory what was said 12 months ago or 14 months ago when we get to these issues. So the meeting notes will be the history of what has been discussed. So it is important that you have them, that you make sure they represent in your view what was said. And with that, then let me ask if anyone has any comments, questions, or additions, edits to the meeting notes of our last meeting. Yes, sir. You were not absent. You were here in the flesh, as it was. Is there a way the staff will take due note? Where is the staff? Somebody will take note of that and make that correction. Thank you. Are there any other? Do we leave off anybody else? Anything? No. With that, may I ask that the minutes be shown as having been unanimously accepted by the group, and I appreciate that. And with that, let us get into the meat of the program. I'd like to introduce to my left, I did not introduce the co-chair of this group, I'm sorry, Janice is the other boss of this organization, and I'm glad to have her here. And to my left is Peter Daly, who's a maritime director of the port, who will take over with the presentations. And you might note that some members of the working group are sitting up here at the table because they have some particular expertise in some of the areas that Peter will discuss. So with that, Mr. Daly. Oh, yeah, we are being moved. I think you're supposed to sail, and I don't know.
Does that work?
Which stand over?
Well, good evening, everybody. While everybody's getting settled, I appreciate the opportunity to be here. It's a lot of deja vu in the room tonight for me. We have our illustrious alumni here, Ann Cook and Carrie Kilstrom and Diane. Of course, we're back here in the 90s when we did the original waterfront plan. Kirk Bennett is one of our alumni is here as well. I've been at the port for about 28 years now and went through the first cycle of the waterfront plan, and I'm glad to see that we are updating it because, let's face it, a lot has changed at the port in that time. And generally, a lot of good has happened at the port in that time. So I have a PowerPoint presentation, of course. I tried to make it as word-free as possible with a lot of pretty pictures so you guys don't all nod off. But I wanted to kind of go through Maritime 101. And we have, as Rudy mentioned, we have some industry experts, some of our tenants, the people who pay the bills for the lights that are on here. That
you just turned them off.
We've got to raise the rates then, I think. But again, I've been at the port for almost 28 years. I've been in the shipping business in San Francisco for my entire professional career. This port means a lot to me. So, getting on with the show, if I can figure out how this thing works. Just overview of the port system in the Bay Area. I try to keep this as light as I possibly can. There, listed here are six ports. There's actually seven. The port of Sacramento, their business is a bit off, so I didn't even put them on there because they don't register to me right now. But each port, sir, is interconnected and does something different of importance to the Bay. So what is the largest port in the Bay? It's the Port of Richmond. The Port of Richmond, with all the crude oil and the liquid chemicals that come through that port in terms of tonnage, they are the largest port in terms of tonnage and value in the Bay. But nonetheless, each port does something unique. Port of Oakland is the general cargo port. 85% of everything that you eat, wear, drive, or look at comes through a container ship someplace in the United States. The Port of Oakland does a lot of export containerized cargo of agricultural goods from the valley out to Asia and to Europe. It's a true intermodal hub, and they've had some bumps in the road like all ports have, other than LA and Long Beach and New York and New Jersey, but they do a very good job of what they do. They have limited harbor services. They have a marina, and they also are the East Bay hub for the ferry, one of the ferry services in the East Bay. Port of Richmond, we talked about, they do bulk cargo, petroleum, automobile imports. We're going to talk about that a little bit later on because it's fascinating. Port of Stockton, a lot of agricultural break bulk cargo, a lot of windmills for alternative energy, for Altamont Pasco and the Stockton project cargoes. Port of Redwood City, bulk cargo, pretty much. They have a little marina, but bulk cargo. We're going to talk about that when we talk about Pier 96 going forward. And then the Port of Benicia, automobiles, some bulk cargoes, and some petroleum going forward. So each port does a little bit of different things. Oakland does not do any bulk cargo. The Port of San Francisco does. We don't do any containers. So we all kind of are connected in the transportation infrastructure of the Bay Area. So the Port of San Francisco, our interconnected maritime industries, it's a mouthful. It didn't sound that bad when I typed it in there. But we have 10 distinct industries. And really briefly, I'm just going to go through each of them and try to, again, just give a basic understanding of what we do and why we do it. I mean, San Francisco, as Commissioner Adams said, was the preeminent Pacific Coast port until like 1955 after World War II. And this is where the war effort in the Pacific was launched. But something happened. Technological change happened. And the invention of the ocean container really changed the face of shipping going forward. And instead of a finger pier, like Pier 1 right here, this was a modern cargo terminal back in the day. It was C&H Sugar, I believe, was the company that brought sugar in from Hawaii through this facility. Railroad cars came right down the, you can see the old railway going down the apron here. So obviously that is not happening anymore. Modern ocean container terminals now are 200, 250 acres. You go to China, 2,000 acres. They're huge expanses of land that are required for that kind of activity. But things changed. The Port of San Francisco's changed. These finger piers were built in the early 1900s. We've looked at these creative new uses such as this at Pier 1, the Exploratorium, Pier 27. But we do have a proud history, and part of that history is the ILWU. And it's San Francisco was the birthplace of the modern port labor movement back in the 30s, the great struggle that today has. It still resonates with San Franciscans. It's in our DNA. And we are a proud union town, and the ILWU has had a very important role going forward. So let's cut to the chase and get into the cargo business, because I know a lot of people have questions about what is cargo, what kind of cargo does the Port of San Francisco, do we handle any cargo? Yeah, we do. This is the Maritime Terminal. It's about 145 acres between Pier 90, I think I have, is there a, no, there isn't, I won't even try. Pier 80 on the my on the right and Pier 94, 96. You can see Heron's Head Park on the far end of the slide. Pier 94 is an active bulk terminal. Pier 80 is a break bulk terminal. What's break bulk? Break bulk is everything you can't fit in a container, such as newsprint. There's big round bales of newsprint that the Chronicle is written on, or your fish is wrapped in, or it's in the bottom of your bird cage. Structural steel, you see steel pipe. We had windmills. You can see a windmill blade coming in from Europe that was sent up to Altamont Pass. We had some fun stuff recently. The Anchored Beer brought some new brewing tanks from Germany. That was fun. We had some not some fun stuff. We had some steel come in for the new Bay Bridge. We had the Central Subway boring machines that allowed the city to construct that Central Subway came through Pier 80. And most recently, we had Tesla Motors brought in their production presses for their new X model through Pier 80. And that's something I'll talk about a little bit later going on. So the break bulk business, like the shipping business since the Great Recession, has been impacted greatly. There's not a lot of manufacturing in San Francisco Bay Area that requires large production presses like the Tesla example that I used. So our break bulk numbers, quite frankly, have been down significantly over the last few years. And we are working on looking at different, as Commissioner Adams mentioned, new different markets. One of the most exciting markets it would be to look at motorized. We've talked to Tesla a number of times. They've been out to Pier 80 looking at the facility to be an export base for their cars going to Asia and to Europe. There are currently more cars being manufactured in Mexico and imported to California than there are coming from Japan. NAFTA has really changed the flow of manufacturing. We think a lot of electric vehicles and imports of vehicles from Mexico for the region, the local region. So instead of having them trucked up from Los Angeles, it would be brought in by ship. So that's one of the exciting opportunities that we think is on very close by, and we can talk a little bit more about it going on. Our real market in terms of cargo is, well, this is a kind of an overlay of, we call it the eco-industrial park or eco-cargo complex. You can see Pier 80 on the top of the slide. You can see Pier 94 a little lower. We have our rail yard. We have representatives from our railroad here, which we'll talk about in a little bit. We have batching plants from Cemex, the largest cement manufacturer in the world, out of, I think they're out of Monterrey, Mexico. Bodie, is it Central now, Brad? Central? Is at Pier 92 as well. And I'm going to talk about the bulk cargo in a minute, because it's actually quite interesting. A lot of these uses were up where Mission Bay was, you know, 10 years ago, and they had to be relocated as a part of the development of the UCSF and the rest of Mission Bay. We had the available land down at Pier 92 and Pier 94, and something interesting happened. We had an empty container terminal at Pier 94. The container shipping went to Oakland, where it probably belongs in a lot of ways. And we found a new business, the bulk cargo business. And it's interesting. Bulk cargo is, you know, like sugar, sand, rock, liquid bulk oil, wine, one of my favorites. So what happened was we found this new niche. We were disadvantaged in the container shipping part of the market because of our bridges and our lack of rail access, of double stack rail access. But we found we were advantaged when it came to the movement of aggregate in from Canada. Aggregate is essentially sand and rock. You mix it with cement and water, and you get concrete. That's what you get. And before we started bringing shiploads of this aggregate into Pier 94, they quarried the aggregate up in Sunol and different parts in the East Bay. And it says there are 35,000 trucks. It's actually closer to 50,000 trucks a year. We're taken off the Bay Bridge and off of Bay Area highways. and this aggregate has now comes in by ship, burning low sulfur fuel, and unloading that cargo immediately at Pier 94, where it's sourced right next door at the two batching plants. So there's a synergy between the batching plants and the aggregate imports that take ease the transportation burden of the city, supplies, construction materials for all the high rises you see going up, for the Warriors Arena, for the cruise terminal, for the new Bay Bridge. The cement was used, the concrete was used for those projects. We have representatives from one of our large bulk cargo tenants here. If there's some questions later on that we can ask them. Oh, I got a pointer. I wish my cat was here. So, I made John Grolinger laugh, so that's my day. So, CEMEX, I talked about them earlier. This is their plant. That's a brand new state-of-the-art plant. All the environmental state-of-the-art environmental processes, again, taking trucks off the road and supplying our vital industry. We talked a little bit about railroad. The port has two locomotives. If you ever want to go on a ride, let me know. We'll take you out on one. Unfortunately, they're circa 1949. They're a little bit long of tooth, but they still operate. We have daily train service into freight rail service into San Francisco. You probably did not know that. But the representatives with the nice hats over here represent San Francisco Bay Rail. They have regular train service at Pier 94, 96, and they can bring cargo in if we need it for shipping, but their primary focus is they take contaminated soils out of San Francisco. Any construction project in San Francisco, you dig a foot into the dirt, there's gonna be a lead contamination back when they used lead paint on construction. And all that soil has to be taken someplace and remediated or buried, and Eric can talk about that later on. But they have daily train service out of the bay, and it's been a very successful operation. It's the last freight rail link in San Francisco. If it were to go away, we'd be the only major city in North America that does not have freight rail access. So it's an important thing going forward. And cargo terminals also, in addition to break bulk cargo, which is stuff that's too big to go in containers, and bulk cargo, which is at Pier 94, we handle, by the way, bulk cargo about 1.5 to 2 million tons a year of cargo into San Francisco. It's a significant amount. We have ships 2 or 3 a month down there. If you ever want to come and see it, give me a call. We'd love to show it to you. But also cargo terminals are important for emergency preparedness and response. We're going to have a big earthquake eventually. Those of us who are at the port in 1989 at Loma Prieta when the ferry building almost fell over remember pretty well. But in terms of recovery, our Pier 80 and 96 have deep water berths, active rail, freeway access, lay down space, covered warehouses and sheds. I think it's vital to maintain that presence in case, or it's not in case, it's going to happen eventually when they're needed. So we're going to go on to a next industry, everybody's favorite, the cruise industry. This is a great picture. This is when the Queen Mary came. Mike, what year was that? 2007. And it was a big deal. Super Bowl Sunday, 2007, and it was a beautiful day like it is today. And I think Carl Nolte did an article in the Chronicle about it coming in. There were thousands of boats that greeted the vessel on its way into the bay. And if you look at this picture carefully, many of you can't see it, but right there is a surfer with a surfboard under his arm. I think that's the coolest thing in the world. But so this ship went to Pier 27 because it was too big to go to our primary cruise terminal at Pier 35, which was built in 1916. And that was kind of the genesis of the Pier 27 project for the new James R. Herman cruise ship terminal. We had the Queen Mary II there. It was successful. It was long enough to handle the berth. The passengers seemed to like the access to the major part of the city. And that was kind of the really eye-opening event when we thought, okay, that facility can work. Well, our cruise business is going great. Our numbers are going strong. Our cruise marketing manager, Mike Nerney, is here, can answer some questions later on. 2015, we're handling over 300,000 passengers, 2016 will be above that, and our bookings for 2017 and 18 look very, very strong. I had talked to a cruise executive the other day. He said, all that free advertising you guys got for the Super Bowl is going to help us sell some tickets at Pier 27. So Commissioner Adams has given us a goal of 1 million passengers. So we're going to work like hell to get it that way, because it's an important industry for the city. Tourism is San Francisco's leading industry. It feeds that business. We're a port city. I think we're a port city. And it reminds people of our maritime DNA. And seeing a beautiful cruise ship on the bay or at port is kind of a neat thing. I mean, I've seen them for years, and I still get a thrill out of seeing them on the waterfront. So James R. Herman Cruise Terminal, Jimmy Herman, and many of you probably knew him, was president of the ILWU, former Port Commission president. He was a civic leader and was a real earnest man about the importance of maritime activity at the port. We're only cruise terminal, I think, in only ocean terminal in North America, maybe anywhere, named after a labor leader. But Jimmy was a real character. He wore these thick glasses, and he couldn't see to save his life. And once I had to drive with him down to Pier 35, I thought I was going to get killed. But it all worked out. So James R. Herman Cruise Terminal, very successful, award-winning. The cruise lines think it's the best cruise terminal in North America. And it's modern. It has all the environmental compliance issues. This is a great ad. This is an old U.S. line ship back in New York, I think back in the day. You can see all the smokestack of all the pollutants and stuff. We're the first port in California to have shoreside power. So when the ships come in, they essentially turn their engines off and they're emission-free. We're really proud of that fact. We were kind of leaders in that. And the cruise lines, Princess Cruises particularly, have been at the forefront in assisting us. So I talked about the interconnectivity of our industries. Well, the more cruise ships we have come in, the more need for ship repair. We have next week a Norwegian Pearl, is it, Mike? Is going to come in. It's a cruise ship coming in from Hawaii. It's an American flag cruise line, I think. Pride of America, I'm sorry. And it's going to be at dry dock for about almost a month. Major renovations of the vessel. There'll be upwards of 2,000 men and women working around the clock from 10 different maritime unions paying family wage jobs. Ship repair, they've been repairing ships at Pier 70 since before the gold rush. And we signed an agreement with our operator, BAE Systems, a British company, to extend this for another 20 years. And we think it's an important part of our maritime history and our economic benefit to the community. The two dry docks, there are two floating dry docks, the port owns both of them. And about 5 years ago, the port entered an agreement with the Carnival Corporation to spend about $5 million to expand the largest of the dry docks to have it able to handle the largest ships in the water, what they call post-Panamax vessels, essentially ships that are too wide or too long to go through the Panama Canal. It's been their record volumes at BAE, at Pier 70. You can see the two dry docks. Here's the large dry dock, number one, and then the Eureka is right there. Vital industry for us, a big economic engine for the city. I think other than the construction trade of building high-rises, it's the leading generator of skilled union jobs in San Francisco. And I'm thrilled that it's going to be. We have challenges in this industry. There's competition. Oops. There's competition up in Portland. There's competition all the time. But it's an important industry going forward. Next industry, harbor services. We have representatives from Westar here tonight. Again, cruise ships, container ships need tugboats. The Bay Bridge retrofit needed tugboats, barges to move cargo and materials and men around and women around the bay. It's a vital industry. We're kind of the hotbed of harbor services in San Francisco Bay. Even though most of the container ships go to Oakland, most of the harbor services are here. San Francisco bar pilots since 1850. Are on San Francisco's waterfront. Right now they're at Pier 9, beautiful offices. You should go in them. They're, now you know why they make so much money, because they have these very spectacular offices. But and then, okay, next industry, the ferries. Everybody's knows that they're right out behind us here. You can see the ferry industry. Oops, that slide's out of place. Well, anyhow, we'll come back to ferries in a second. Bay and Delta Harbor Services. I'm sorry, I'm out of whack here. Bay and Delta, this is an interesting story, the fight between development and maritime. Bay and Delta was at Pier 15 before. Exploratorium came on board. They wanted Piers 15 and 17. And the port said, okay, well, what are we going to do with this tenant? Well, it was an interesting solution. The Exploratorium said, okay, we get it. We will craft a new home for Bay and Delta, who now has a long-term deal at Pier 17, an important maritime industry. It's alongside the Exploratorium. Kids love tugboats, by the way. I got to tell you that right now. They just love them. So it's kind of a win-win with the Exploratorium. It, also in the Exploratorium development, we've got a new tugboat operation fixed up by the Exploratorium. We have a new water taxi landing on the Pier 15 from the Exploratorium. And in a little bit, I'll show you a slide. I'll tell you a small story that is kind of interesting. But here it is. Here's the slide. This is visiting historic ships. This is the Exploratorium at 1517. So we told the Exploratorium, look, we don't, the face of 1517 is a deep water berth. We don't have to dredge it. It's, we got to keep it in the new plan. Well, no, they didn't really want it. It was, Byron remembers this conversation pretty well. And we kind of talked about it and said, look, it could be kind of cool. Well, we don't really want it to block our views, blah, 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 blah. Well, we had this, we finally convinced them, no, you got to have the deep water berth. You got to protect that berth. Once it goes, like Commissioner Adams says, it's gone. So they said, okay. So they fixed the fendering up and they put the bollards in. We brought these training ships there. They think it's the greatest thing they've ever seen in their life. They're walking around with bell bottoms and pea coats right now. But it shows you how development and maritime can coexist. They don't have to be fighting each other all the time. They can both benefit each other, and I think this is a good example of it. Ferries, back on track with my slides here. You know, the bay is a wonderful highway. There's not a lot of traffic. You have to wait in line, or 9 million passengers a year, 365 days around the year. Ferry service is going to expand going forward with the Water Emergency Transit Authority. Carolyn's Blue and Gold Fleet, Carolyn's the president of Blue and Gold Fleet, is the operator for WIDA. We have Golden Gate Ferry here. Those numbers are probably a little low. I think it's gone higher from then. Ferries were very important the last week with the Super Bowl. We had a lot of people, I think we were packed to the gills. And so anyhow, it's a vital industry for us. It's growing exponentially. The state of California through WIDA understands the importance of it. The ferry terminals are right behind you. Well, you don't have to look, they're right here too. So, but the good news is, you know, we have a plan to expand the ferry facilities. We're gonna, I'm not sure this is the exact rendition, but essentially we're adding new berths behind the ferry building on the south side of the building. We're gonna clean up the access around the ferry building so people can queue in an orderly manner. But I think, you know, 5 years from now when you come down here, you're gonna see a lot more ferry operations and ferry boats. We have Captain Ray Shipway, who represents the master's mates and pilots who drive those boats over here as well, so we can ask him some questions later on. Excursion boats. Tourism is our leading industry. People love to go in the bay if they've never been here before. I got them all in there, I think. I got red and white, yeah, check. Blue and gold, check. But your boat's bigger than Tom's, I just wanted to, or your logo. And Hornblower next door, who operates the service out to Alcatraz. Important union employers, people who visit San Francisco, get out of the bay. It's, you know, you see them all the time. It's a wonderful, another maritime industry. And water taxis. We have both of our water taxi operators. I think we have Tideline and San Francisco Water Taxi, the two different types of boats. This is, you know, kind of up and down the waterfront from Fisherman's Wharf down to Pier 40. We think this is going to be expanding going forward. I think in the summertime, people love to get on a boat right here at Pier 1 or 1.5, and they can go up to Fisherman's Wharf for 10 bucks, the whole family. Dave Thomas, the president of San Francisco Water Taxi, and I think somebody from Tideline is, yep, in the back over there too, can answer any questions you have as well. It's a wonderful experience. You know, some of the big tech companies are looking at some sort of a point-to-point water taxi service to get their employees down to the South Bay. We'll see how that grows going forward. But 5 years ago, we had no water taxis. Now we have two. I bet you 5 years from now, we'll have a few more. Commercial fishing and processing. It's the heart of Fisherman's Wharf, and how am I doing for time? I'm pretty good. You know, there was always a fight to keep, back when we did the waterfront plan in 97, was keep the fish in Fisherman's Wharf. After Loma Prieta in 89, Pier 45, which was the center of the seafood industry, Pier 45 was pretty much demolished from the earthquake. The fish processors all left. The port got some FEMA money. Kirk Bennett was involved in that project. He got me involved in it. It was actually one of my funnest projects, the more fun I've had it in a long time at that project. But we renovated the pier, and we built a new Hyde Street Harbor, which is for transient and bigger fishing boats. And now Pier 45 is the leading fish processing and commercial center in California, maybe, you know, one of the largest on the West Coast. If you walk down there, normally people go down to Fisherman's Wharf and you see all the tourists, and you go down by Pier 45, you go there about 1 p.m., it looks dead, like there's nothing going on. Go there about 6 in the morning, it looks like, it's like the Tokyo Fish Market. I mean, there's fish flying everywhere, it's fantastic. And, you know, when you go to Farallon or all the fancy frou-frou restaurants here in San Francisco and you order fish, it came through Pier 45. It's an active, thriving business. Although, we've had some challenges. Yesterday at the Port Commission, Dungeness crab, the level of demonic acid, I think I got it right, is too high. So the Northern California crab season has not opened. They do 95% of their business between Thanksgiving and Chinese New Year. We're past all those milestones. The industry, the fishermen, the deckhands, the processors, are a lot of them are on just hanging in there. The mayor, Mayor Lee, and Port Commission yesterday announced our crab industry relief plan, where we are relieving the fishing fleet and the crab processors their fees for a 3-month period to get them over the hump until salmon season, keep your fingers crossed, opens up later this spring. It's a vital, important industry. We had a tenant yesterday, Jeanette Kaido from Kaido Fisheries. She came up to the podium during the commission meeting. She said, "My family's been a port tenant since 1862. So that's some street cred right there. So fishing last, South Beach Harbor. We didn't own this the last time we did the waterfront plan update. South Beach Harbor, 750 slip marina, one of the largest marinas in Northern California. It's port property, and it was under lease to the Redevelopment Agency, who ran it for 25 years. It was built before the ballpark was built, and that whole, you know, Gold Coast emerged out on the Southern Waterfront. Beautiful marina. So the Redevelopment Agencies went away. The port took back the marina. And it needed some love. It was underwater financially to the tune of about $1 million a year. There was deferred maintenance. It was, you know, it was 25 years old when we got it, about a 50-year lifespan. It needed a facelift or two. But the good news is we've been able to turn it around at South Beach. We've had some tough medicine. We've raised the rates to a market level. We've updated the staff and increased the security down there, and now the facility this past year, I'm happy to say, has earned $1 million, which that $1 million isn't going to go to this building. It's going to go back into South Beach Harbor to protect that, you know, jewel in the crown of the Southern Waterfront or the Central Waterfront. So it's been another success story. Joe Monroe, our new harbor master, was going to try to be here today, but he got hung up with some other activities. So, other challenges, I'm almost done, I promise. You know, the conflict points that I see in a lot of the areas that this group will be discussing of, you know, public access versus maritime operations. It's a conflict at times. This is the apron along Pier 27, and you can see when these things right here are davit cranes with the shoreside power. You don't want to put your fingers in those sockets because you will just disappear. We have forklifts, we have our gangway, there's working equipment. But the deal we cut with the public, you know, access folks is we're going to keep this this gate open when there's not a ship in port. We are a little concerned about it, but we're going to experiment. And so far, you know, it's been good. And if it's not open, John calls me at home, which is fine. I'm glad he does. But I think we're getting the hang of keeping the gates open at the right time. You're the guy calling my wife, huh? Okay. So that's an issue. And Pier 19 is another one. You know, we did the apron for the America's Cup. The apron's beautiful. The fendering's great. But it's a public access pier. And some of the boats that call there need security. And security is a big issue. Since 1997, since 9/11, security is ramped up. You used to be able to walk on a cruise ship just by flashing your business card. Now it's like going on going to the airport. Security at the port, I didn't belabor it with this presentation, but it's a serious business. We're a unique port. The city bumps up right against the port of San Francisco. So it plays into our land use issues going forward. And so enough about security. Next issue. Human-powered craft. I know we have a representative from the kayakers here, so I'll try to be gentle. The human-powered craft near shipping lanes. It's a bit of a scary issue from time. We've had, this is actually kind of a, I saw this picture today, and it's sad, and I'll tell you why. Not because the guy who took the picture or anything happened to him, but about 4 years ago, we had a kayaker right in that same location. This is an old dry dock that we finally got rid of. In Islas Creek, and right on the other side of the creek, a tugboat started its motor, its engine, and the water flipped over the kayaker. The kayaker, it was never found again, and died. So we're very concerned about these kind of conflicts. I know the Coast Guard and the Harbor Safety Committee is as well. We think we can work out an equitable solution. We just have to all use our heads and work together to make sure we don't put people in harm's way. I have a solution, though, is right here. This is our new Homeland Security. So that's another issue. And I think, dredging expense. You know, to maintain these, as Commissioner Adams said, that, you know, to dredge, it costs us about $6, $7 million a year to dredge our harbor. It's very expensive. The regulations are, and they should be. They're very strict, but it's an expensive process. And if you don't keep, the federal government's got, I don't know how many billions of dollars of our money that the importers and exporters pay for this harbor maintenance tax, and they don't give us any, so we have to do our own dredging. It's a shame. It's an issue that you're going to hear more and more about going forward, but that's a big issue for us, the expense of dredging. And then, of course, another challenge is environmental sustainability. We want to be a green port. We got the memo. We get it. We are an old port. We have infrastructure, old pipes, old facilities. But I think through Heron's Head Park, some of the park work that we're doing, the shoreside power, I think that you'll see continued great things from the port. And if you don't, pressure us, and we'll continue to be as green as we possibly can going forward. So I think that is it, and I appreciate your attention. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for a lovely and informative presentation. Peter, we have a commitment to end these proceedings at 8. I would like to get as many people an opportunity to ask questions as possible, consistent with your putting on the people that you brought here to speak to us. So if you would, how do you want to proceed? You want to put your folks on now and hold on the questions for a little while?
Well,
Peter, then why don't you go ahead and put on those folks whom you want to put on, say, for half an hour, and then we'll have half hour for questions if you want to do that.
Well, I'm putting people on the spot here a little bit. I know there are a lot of community people from the community here, which is important. We have a lot of folks here. We have a lot of people here who actually pay my salary through the money that they pay to the port.
Oh, we need a microphone for you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
May you try pressing one of these buttons and see if it goes?
So,
you know, I might just sing a song instead. I think that'd be fun. But we have representatives from San Francisco Bay Rail. We have Mike Bishop from our bulk cargo operation in Southern Waterfront. We have Ray Shipway from the Masters Mates and Pilots. Dave Thomas, the water taxi operation. Rich Smith, the general manager of our harbor services, Westar Marine, Tideline Marine. We have Denise Turner, our wharfinger of 38 years, who's retiring next week, is here. She has more institutional knowledge than anybody. Let's hear it for Denise, who is literally after 38 years.
So we are actually going to finish our presentation, and then we're going to leave you a good hour for the discussion. We think it'll go faster that way. So I tried to put myself before Peter because it's always hard to follow all those great slides and jokes. And I'm going to talk about planning a little bit, which I know isn't nearly as much fun. So I'm going to try to be very brief and be done by 7, if not sooner. So I wanted to give a little bit of the context for the work that we are doing here. This is the Waterfront Plan Update process. All those wonderful projects didn't just happen. They happened because of a very firm commitment over time by the Port Commission, by the port staff, and through the Waterfront Land Use Plan process itself. And of course, we're updating that plan, and we want to hear from our maritime tenants, since that's the purpose of this meeting. But I just wanted to give a little planning context, and then we'll dive back into that question and answer period. So thank you for that. As I just mentioned, I'm going to be talking about maritime planning and policies, long-time commitment on the behalf of the port in response to Port Commission direction. The most important thing, of course, in this room is the Waterfront Land Use Plan. You've had a very thorough overview of that already in November. And then we talked about the regulations that affect waterfront planning last month. And so I just wanted to very briefly talk about how we plan for maritime in particular. It is a waterfront land use plan. It's not just a maritime plan. But in our planning process, and because it is one of our core functions under the public trust, we put maritime first in that planning process. And we just want to give you a chance to see how we did that in the plan and how we've done that since. So there's several goals of the plan, but the first goal you'll come across in the waterfront plan is for a working waterfront. And all the industries that Peter talked about, we went through a very deliberate process. We had 26 meetings. A lot of people in this room were on panels for each industry. And we reserved as much property as we possibly could for maritime uses, for both the existing uses and then ample property for what we expected to be the expansion uses for those maritime uses. And we had 3 levels of policies, still do. These are the policies that we use to do things like the cruise terminal and the exploratorium project, the ballpark, all those projects were done through the waterfront land use plan. There's the first level is general policies for our maritime uses, for existing maritime uses. We wanted to be sure that we did things like provide long-term leases and incentives for our maritime businesses so that they could really pay for a lot of the improvements that they needed and amortize them over time. We knew that in some cases, our smaller businesses weren't able to make those improvements, so that was where the concept for maritime mixed uses came in, that you could leverage a private developer to fix the pier, do the fendering, improve the apron, help with the deep berth, Pier 1517 is the perfect example, and get the maritime improvements paid for through that. So the idea of leveraging private development was really important. Avoid land use conflicts wherever we can. We can't always do that. We have to do a lot of workarounds and workouts, and you're certainly going to hear about that tonight from our maritime tenants. Protect truck and rail access, and then provide public access wherever we could. And that is, you know, another one of our key challenges on an operational basis. But it's something that we work very diligently, both with our tenants and with the public access and our regulatory folks as well. We also had expansion areas that we mentioned. So when Peter showed you the slide of the ferry building, for example, we have a few berths at the time. We even had one that's no longer there, Pier 1 half. And then we have expansion areas that were preserved in the waterfront plan that will now allow the expansion of the ferry. So that was also a very deliberate effort. The expectation was most of the heavy industrial uses would move down to the southern waterfront. Most of them were there already, although we still had cotton warehouse and newsprint warehouse on the northern waterfront. And then once again, the notion of mixing in the smaller scale commercial and recreational uses in the northern waterfront was very key. Drilling down a little bit further, we had the five sub areas, continued to use that as a planning tool. And each of those sub areas had objectives for the maritime and other uses. So for example, at Fisherman's Wharf, restore and expand the working fishing port. But also there's a lot of other maritime industries up there. There's the historic ship Pompanito, there's a recreational marina, and the ferries and excursions as well. So once again, getting down to the sub-area level, and then we got down to the site level with things like the Hyde Street Harbor project, which Peter also showed. So once again, complete the harbor as soon as possible. I like this slide because we can say, check, we did that. Give priority to harbor support services, including a fish alley. Did that. Allow recreational boats. They are allowed only when they're not needed for fishing industry. Done. So each of these things has been completed pursuant to the plan. And then another really important way that we protect maritime in the plan is for each of the sub areas, there's this acceptable land use table. And you'll notice, like for the ferry building, we say which of the maritime uses are acceptable and not. But within this plan, we also reserve the right on the port of the Port Commission to place maritime industries wherever they can on the waterfront, wherever they need to. We tried to show here what we thought were the best matches with the surrounding land use, but reserve that power in the Port Commission to make maritime a priority always. We've created a Maritime Commerce Advisory Committee in 1999, and I'm not going to go through this whole slide just in the interest of time and because I know Ellen wants to speak to it, but they're a very important partner to the port, made up of a lot of the tenants here that advocate, work together, collaborate, and work with city agencies to make sure that maritime remains a priority always at the port. The San Francisco Water Bay Trail is kind of a new initiative. The slides that Peter showed are great, but they are very true that we now are working actively, as we should, to have more recreational boating on the waterfront. There are some concerns that we have to work out on an operational level to make sure that everybody stays safe. Transportation, you all know, is a very huge issue. It's an issue that we work very hard for, and we have a lot of control over what happens in the water. We work with our sister agencies and regional agencies on the land side. We have a little less control there, but we work as partners because we know it's so important to all of us and especially to our maritime tenants. Just to put this meeting in perspective, we are down here on, got the wrong thing in my hand, February 10th. We are working through an orientation process, for those of you who haven't been in the room before, where we're trying to arm our working group and the public with all the information we think that they need to have in order to make policy trade-off discussions in this part two. We are working on maritime berthing. We define the issue very narrowly. We know our maritime community has more concerns than just berthing, but the notion here is that we really need to do a good job figuring out in this waterfront plan this balance between maritime berthing and the public access, landside and waterside. We have ongoing work that we're always doing to try to make these maritime uses work and function very well in a very changing dynamic city. And then the kind of what else is just the way I'm sort of setting up the discussion for the Q&A that now Peter can do again.
Take some questions from the group now, or would you want to wait until Peter's done? Anne?
Questions.
Questions for Anne? Anybody at the moment? Okay, good. Okay, Peter, before we start, I said at the beginning that we have some members of the working group who are actually sitting at the table here because of their special area of expertise in maritime matters. And perhaps this would be a good time to have them share their wisdom with us. Ellen Jonk is here, and maybe Ellen, if you want to start, and then we'll go from there to Carolyn Horgan and Christina Rupke, who are all sitting at the table. So take a minute or two and tell us.
Thank you. Yourself. Well, I'm Ellen Jonk, and I've been honored for at least maybe a little more than 5 years to be co-chair of the Maritime Commerce Advisory Committee, along with Marina Secatano of the Inland Boatmen's Union. And you saw the slide up there about the Maritime Commerce Advisory Committee and our role in being an advocate and educator of the public, the mayor, all the institutions in the city of San Francisco and regulatory agencies to say why we think maritime is important and want to make sure that maritime interests are considered in planning for the city. And I have to just say to all of you, the meetings are open. We meet four times a year. We did spend two meetings talking about the waterfront plan and how we want to be involved. And we do want to be very involved through the whole process. You'll hear from some of the members of the committee, just a couple, some of the comments that we made, spending two meetings talking about how we thought the planning process should go, what we wanted to see the result and the outcome of it. And one of the major comments was, well, it's called the waterfront plan, but we said, why isn't it called the port plan? Well, we know we had, you know, Proposition H, and that is what it's called, but we want everyone to think about the port, because the port is the institution through which the waterfront runs and all the activities run through it. We also like y'all to think about, this is a primer tonight, but going forward and thinking about policy, more about how we resolve conflicts, for instance, between public access and maritime activities, and particularly transportation has been a big issue. I've appeared before the Muni MTA here in the city on behalf of MCAC, asking them to please remember that we do have a port here in the city of San Francisco, and we do need to move cargo through and have open throughways, so to speak, for trucking and for cargo. And I think the other points that we've made to the city. In fact, we had a sail-in a little over a year ago, and maybe we need to do that again. But we have a maritime preservation policy. Maybe it should be the maritime preservation and development policy. We made some changes to that recently, further emphasizing the value of the bay and the port for water transport and for public transportation on the water. And I think we can do some more in looking at that policy and how we can really beef it up and let the citizens of San Francisco know what we really think is important. And I think personally for me, there's two areas that I'd like you to think about. I'm also fortunate to be an appointee of the mayor to the Historic Preservation Commission. And we have Aaron Hyland here, who is also a member and a colleague commissioner. And also Mike Bueller represents San Francisco Heritage. But I think the value, we want the citizens of San Francisco to know the value, the maritime heritage here. And of course, with the nomination of the Embarcadero Historic District and some of our historic buildings at Pier 70, I think folks are remembering here that we very have a strong, as Peter said, it's in our DNA. And the other point I'd just like you to think about, we have over $1 billion in deferred maintenance for our infrastructure. And I listened to the budget presentation yesterday, and even though the revenue is strong, we still have a lot of deferred maintenance that just really needs to be taken care of. And I have a particular interest in seeing the opportunity in the future for a general obligation bond on the city ballot that would be an investment for the port. We invest in our schools, we invest in our muni, I think maybe it's time for the city to invest in our port. So those are my comments on behalf of MCAC, and there's members here who have some more things to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. It's good to have you with us, and I couldn't agree more about the general obligation bond. It's an argument we've had for some years, and it's time to get it done. Ms. Horgan?
I'm Carolyn Horgan, and I'm the president of Blue and Gold Fleet. We we operate most of the ferries in the area, as well as excursion vessels on San Francisco Bay. And, you know, we see the ferry industry growing, which is wonderful. Oops.
They can't hear you. I apologize.
That's all right. So there's a conflict that we have because these boats that we operate need to be repaired, and we have a maintenance facility at Pier 9, which has been a maintenance facility probably for about 35 years. And, you know, we bring boats in there, we do heavy maintenance, welding, you know, just the kind of work that you need to do to maintain a boat. And we have seen an influx recently of high-tech companies who are coming into the port and coming to Pier 9 because it's kind of cool, you know, to be down at the port. People like being near the water, and, you know, I get it. But I think the port then is in a very difficult position, just because what Ellen was saying, with all the deferred maintenance, and if there's not, and you have these people coming in and offering to pay these, do wonderful, I mean, they've done an incredible job on the pier. They've spent a lot of their own money on it, and we can't afford that. And my concern is that when our lease comes up for renewal at Pier 9, Pier 9 is a facility we need badly, that we're going to be competing with these companies that can afford to pay whatever, and we're going to be pushed out. And I think the port is in a tough position. I understand that. But I do believe, and it seems like everything we hear and the waterfront plan is clear, is that maritime is a priority, and we can't really operate our business unless we have a facility where we can do that maintenance. And I think someone... the analogy was made, you know, you buy a house next to an airport, and then you complain about the planes coming and going because, you know, there's complaints from this tenant about they want to block the way we have trucks that come in from our vendors, and we get complaints that they're taking up too much of the driveway, et cetera. So I think this is the tip of the iceberg, and I just think we need to take a stand, and we should need to figure out what the compromise can be that will work for the maritime industry and the Port of San Francisco.
Thank you. Ms. Rupke, do you have anything you want to add to this?
I don't know
if working mic here, I guess. Does it work? Do we have a working mic up here other than this one? Hey, you guys, we're not going to solve the port's problems until you first solve the mic problem.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Hi. So I'm Christina, and I'm an avid sailor, and I work, I'm the keelboat director for the Bay Area Association of Disabled Sailors, and we're located, thankfully and luckily, at South Beach Harbor here in San Francisco. But basically, I mean, I think when we're looking at the maritime uses with respect to this waterfront plan, and we're looking at the Bay Trail sites in particular, which are, in my mind, most relevant to recreational boating, I think the most relevant conflict that I see, or the most relevant challenge that I see when we move forward, is that, you know, it's the same thing that we're all talking about, which is kind of the fight for space and competing uses. But when you have recreational boating, you often need parking, which is a totally non-controversial topic here in San Francisco. And you need access, you know, for Bay Trail sites. My understanding is that one of the considerations is, you know, boaters need to have a safe place to park nearby so that they can park overnight and have, you know, day-long excursions. And that kind of directly runs against, or not necessarily, you know, it doesn't have to conflict directly, but it seems to have some tension with the city and port's kind of just transit-first policy and the idea that we want sustainable modes of transportation to prevail over private automobile use. So I think it's important that as we move forward, we remember to make all of our boating facilities as open and accessible to everyone, including people with disabilities, which is, of course, challenging. But if we make it accessible to people with disabilities, we make it accessible to folks that are growing older in our society, we have a more active population, save on healthcare costs, all those great things. So we have a lot of good opportunities, and so we just need to kind of figure out how to make the all the uses kind of come together. So I think those are my only comments relevant to tonight. Thanks.
Thank you so much. In the interest of time, Peter has decided, has suggested that instead of having all of our guests make a statement, we will devote their time instead to your questions. But we'd like to at least acknowledge their presence here, and if Peter would just say who the folks are that are here and what they represent, I think that would be helpful. Then you also know to whom to direct your questions as they come to you. Go ahead, Peter.
Thanks, Rudy. We have representatives from the railroad. Eric, you wave your hand, is the general manager of the rail operations, and is Nick here, or Nick's here, and
our CFO, Larry.
A CFO is here from the rail operation. Captain Ray Shipway from Seattle is the Master's Mason Pilots president, I guess, or whatever the heck you are.
Regional representative for the state of California.
We have Mike Bishop from the bulk cargo operation, one of the port's biggest tenants. Of course, we have Commissioner Adams, who represents ILWU. Rich Smith and his new... Blake Miller is taking part of Rich's job. He's retiring next month, or this month, actually. But Rich has been a mainstay on the port for years, and is the general manager of Westar Marine down at Pier 50. We have Dave Thomas from San Francisco Water Taxi, and a representative from, I forgot your name.
Nathan,
and he was at the Port Commission yesterday, from Tideline. I'm forgetting somebody here. Of course, Carolyn is here. She's the excursion. Chris Christensen from the ILWU. Karen from SWAC, and she's well-versed in a lot of these Southern Waterfront industrial maritime uses. And Ellen, of course, our leader of the MCAC. So everybody's here to answer any questions.
There's ferry people, too. There's
ferry people. Where are the ferry people? I don't see you. Way in the back. Is that Joe Burgard, the general manager or president of Red and White Fleet? I hope you didn't hear the joke I said about Red and White earlier, did you?
You didn't even recognize him.
Darn it. But Joe down at Fisherman's Wharf in Red and White. And who's in the back there?
Mike
Darity from WIDA. Got Fred Pecker from Local 6. We have everybody's here. So if you got a question... let's hear it, and we're not very threatening, really. We can answer anything.
Well, thank you all for coming, and I think there's a hand up. Are you seeking to be recognized, or you want to be introduced? I can't see you back there. There you go. Okay, hi.
Oh.
Okay.
Well,
would you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, I'm John Tobias. I'm a member of
the
working group.
Yep.
We just heard from the lady from Blue and Gold, I think, kind of about some of the issues that she sees for her business coming up. And I was just wondering. I thought it would be nice to hear actually, kind of from all the businesses, sort of that perspective a little bit, so that we can get a little bit better understanding of, you know, what they're facing, what they see, what they would like to see, that sort of thing.
Okay, Peter, who would you like to have take that on?
This is fun. I get to... Rich Smith, since he's retiring, can be completely honest, honestly. So I think Rich has got some good things to say, because he's seen this conflict up close and personal.
Okay, thank you for your question.
Yeah, hi, I'm Rich Smith. I'm general manager of Westar Marine Services. Port tenant for 40 years, about 19 of them at Pier 50. Harbor Services Company offering tugboat, barge, and water taxi services, and we do have to be at a pier to conduct our business. And there are a lot of ongoing land use conflicts with the maritime conflicts. So what I really wanted to say was to encourage the work group to really consider maritime as your priority in this planning process, to make sure that all the maritime uses are considered first and foremost. Some examples of land use conflicts are closures of Terry Francois Boulevard, you know, on a monthly or more often basis for runs or activities at the parking lot for the Giants. And our employees have difficulty getting to work, our customers can't get in, trucks that are bringing supplies to go out to the ships can't get in. I've personally sat at the end of Pier 50 for an hour waiting to go home because there's a marathon going on. So Another example, the port recently signed a lease with a company to operate the old restaurant that's down at the foot of Pier 50, the old Jelly's restaurant. And that's created operational restrictions on us because the port fire marshal decided that we couldn't be loading barges while people were in the restaurant. So we're working through those problems, but this is just an ongoing type of thing that, you know, in my 17 years at West Star, that it's something you always just got to be on the lookout for, and you got to fight for your lease rights. Thank you.
Thank you. Follow-up questions? Other questions, folks? Got to be some questions.
I have a question.
Janice.
Janice Lee, chair of the working group. So one of my questions is, and it was touched very, very briefly, I think, Anna, at the end of your presentation, but really sea level rise. And so I know that that interacts a lot with maritime industry. And so I certainly have concerns with developing and you're dumping a lot of really critical money into critical repairs and the needs for the maritime industry as sea level rise is happening. So what are the internal conversations either at the MCAC or Peter, you know, what do those conversations look like right now? And what are those concerns with developing at the water's edge?
Great question, serious topic. The sea level rise, I mean, the mayor and the city have a sea level rise task force and climate change task force. Obviously, the seawall of the Port of San Francisco dates back in many places, you know, decades, almost 100 years. On high tide now, to your point, in the winter when you have these king tides, and if you have any kind of swell or any kind of storm, you can see the water already breaking over the Embarcadero by the ag buildings just south of the ferry building. The nightmare scenario, if you go a little bit, about 20 yards west, you have the Muni Metro tunnel, which is right there, which if that got inundated, it would flood not only Muni Metro, but BART. And so, I mean, I think at a pay grade much higher than mine, the city is cognizant of the need to fortify, you know, the port in terms of both the seawall. I mean, the seawall in case of emergency or of a seismic event, you know, could be another catastrophe. I mean, people have to remember there's a map upstairs on the third floor that dates back to 1864, and you see the original water line. Go up to the Transamerica building. That's right where it is. So we're on reclaimed land. It's a serious, serious issue. Commissioner Adams and I were in Shanghai last year, and they've already started addressing it. They've already started building up their walkways along the Bund, and they're way ahead of us in terms of dealing with this kind of a threat. It's a serious, serious topic. And to Rudy's point earlier, I mean, I don't think the port can solve it by ourselves. It's a bigger issue than just us. It might be a bigger issue than just the city. But in terms of fortifying the port of the inner part of the bay, I think there's got to be some funding sources. It's very expensive to repair a seawall. I think they're facing this up in Seattle with their Alaskan Viaduct being destructed and their new tunnel system up there. So I don't have the answer, but I know Brad and others here at the port, Brad Benson, have been very, very involved. And Brad, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that or not.
And I'll make a brief comment after.
So can you repeat the question for me? Because I just came in from outside.
Sea level rise and its impact on the port and our maritime industries.
Well, I think sea level rise is going to impact the entire port, and I know that there will be a session dedicated to looking at resiliency issues, both seismic risk to the seawall, which is the study that's ongoing now and will be releasing shortly. In terms of sea level rise, the city is taking a look at sea level rise, really the planning department and the Department of Public Works have been leading a look into sea level rise. We just received new maps looking at a variety of sea level rise scenarios. for the port over the next 50 to 100 years. And, you know, I think generally, given the level of sea level rise projected for the next 30 years, we're going to be okay. We're going to be able to continue to operate our maritime industries. We may need improvements in a few areas. There's some low areas just south of the agriculture building that we'll need to address, which could be part of the WIDA project in that area. But long term, we're going to need to think and be creative about our shoreline and whether or not the current shoreline can protect downtown. And I think we'll be exploring those issues with the planning department and through the seawall project. So
I just want to make a comment on that. I appreciate it. I know that there's going to be a topic later on that specifically looks at sea level rise, environmental sustainability. But my question here is really specific to maritime industry. If it's going to cost so much, we have to be really mindful about the costs that there are for maritime industry specifically, because a lot of the maritime industry is right at the water's edge. We have to think about, just be real with those costs, and if those are costs that the city and the port are really willing to take, and if not, then what are our other possibilities? And I think that there was a comment over here as well.
I actually just wanted to get in, jump in line with the question. So I don't know. Can I go?
I'm sorry.
Christina,
she has a question.
Okay, please.
Oh, so I have questions related to water transportation, so both with respect to the small water taxis and also WIDA operations. So my question with respect to the water taxis is whether there are any plans to make them wheelchair accessible in the future as we expand those operations, and what are the challenges around doing so if there's not a plan. And then the second part, which is more related to ferry service, is whether, in addition to the other plans that I've heard as far as expansion of that of ferry service, if there's any plans or are there any discussions going on around using the ferry landing over by the Giants ballpark more often than just Giants games? Just because I know we've all talked about how stressed our transportation system is and how along the waterfront it's really hard getting around a lot of times. So I was just wondering if people have comments on either of those.
Peter, whom would you like to have handle that question?
Dave and or Tideline. The question was regarding ADA access for the water taxis going forward.
Can you hear me? You asked a really good question. In fact, we discussed that question on the original interview for the water taxis. The problem is the mechanics of the boat. They're small boats. It's really a Coast Guard question. The Coast Guard, we are stuck in the position if the boat goes down, we have 18 passengers. Does the captain put his effort in the 17 he can save or the one he probably can't? And it is a real moral issue. I can tell you this, that all the regulations in the Coast Guard have what they call a bloodline. Somebody died to get that regulation in the book. And the Coast Guard is looking at the issue. We've asked for readouts on it. We've not had a definitive answer, and we're waiting for it.
Christina, you might want to have a comment to that. Do you?
Of course I do, but I don't know. I can talk to you afterwards. I'd be interested in talking more about it, but I don't need to monopolize the meeting.
Good, Karen?
We have another operator from Tideline.
Mike, please.
Just to support what was just said, the Coast Guard has overwhelming jurisdiction on what we can do and what we cannot do. However, we have new vessels coming online that will be ADA accessible. Where now, some of the issues that we have is the actual landing dock itself. So when we get up to the landing dock, the ability for us to have the type of ramp, I think the Exploratorium's new landing dock is I think represents what we're hoping to see more of in the future that allows for wheelchair access, and we are outfitting our boats to be amenable to that, to wheelchairs, yes.
And just the other part of your question, Christina, was the China Basin ferry landing, more use of it. I believe, Denise, you can correct me for Denise Turner, it was it's a winter thing. There's a storm swell in the creek, Mission Creek. So we put up the ramp when there's not a ball game, but it was down for the Metallica concert.
So.
Can I just add one more point?
Yes, quickly.
We're able to land at McCovey Cove, which is what we do, so not necessarily right at the ballpark, but we do land at McCovey Cove regularly.
Well, we hurry this process along to make lots of time for questions, but are there any questions? Questions, yes, please. Go ahead. Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I have a question on the cruise terminal. President Adams would like to see 1 million passengers a year come. And reading through the materials, we currently, well, you said there were 300,000 currently arriving, and that's 82 calls. I'm wondering what the capacity, actually, of our new cruise terminal is. It said that the terminal actually needs now to do a lot of special events to help augment the revenue, because the current revenue from cruises isn't covering the bill. So can the cruise terminal, as it currently exists, actually handle 1 million people and whatever the ports of the call that is? And there's lots of other references in our points of concern that we need to really maintain all of the deep water berths. So I'm kind of wondering if that is related to that.
Mike, I can talk to Mike. By the time he walks over here and gives me the mic, I'll just say we have Pier 27, which is a single berth terminal, true. But we also still have Pier 35 open that has two other berths. We use the terminal now for 85 days a year. It's available for 365. And Mike?
Right. So that's what I was going to say, too, is we have 80 calls a year, roughly, and 300,000 passengers. So the special events fit in between the cruise ships. But if we had 300 cruise ship calls, then we wouldn't have as many special events. It was built as primarily as a cruise ship terminal, and as Peter pointed out, we have two berths at Pier 35. So there are times during the year where we have three ships in it one day, but it's primarily built as a cruise ship terminal, and so the events are secondary.
Thank you. I'm sorry. You want to finish that, please?
I just want to add is that in terms of revenue to the port, we make more money from cruise ships than we do from special events, so that's the priority. And we did a presentation to the Port Commission a few months ago that's showing the bottom line of the cruise terminal. With the cruise ship activity growing and the special event activity, the place makes money. It's not subsidized, which in government is pretty good.
Okay, we'll go to Linda and then to John.
Thank you, Commissioner Adams, for the comprehensive view of the maritime industry, not only in the Bay Area, but throughout the country. The question that I have are we paying attention to all the massive development that are currently taking place? I'm on the Treasure Island Development Authority, and we're building a city within a city. I have the privilege of chairing the Transportation and the Infrastructure Committee. We've gone up ahead of the city. I know that Janet Lee, you mentioned, great question about climate change. Actually, I've been holding sessions for months now, and I don't think we need to reinvent the wheel. We've brought in experts of the best in the world working with us, and they've even given us a lot of information about the San Francisco waterfront line. So I'm committing myself here that we would like to give those expertise. Those are the folks you need to be working with right now. We have them at the table, and we can utilize their expertise. Now, the question that I want to ask before has to do with public access versus development. And if security is the given, That is really not a conflict. Regardless of what kind of access we're providing, we know that we need to have adequate securities for all the facilities. I mean, that it is. And if that is the case then, and we are expanding our transportation, again, I'd like to see a lot of the ferries, water taxis, you know, locally operated and all of the stuff, their expansion. I think what we need to do then is have a broader discussion on basically what we mean in terms of public access. I would like to, again, different forums to really go through that so we can talk about the challenges. And I don't foresee so many challenges if security is a given, but some of those land use restrictions, I think we can better explain to the public so they can comprehend why we've got to have those restrictions where the public, under any circumstance, will not be allowed to be at this facility. It's just a given. There's no way around that, just like at the San Francisco airport or any of those, you cannot go there, but there are still restricted public access. So I think private-public developments are the way of the future. We just need to explore working with you know, maritime as a goal. I think we can explore uses that will be compatible. Again, make compensate, you know, currently what we have. The exploratorium is a good project that, you know, is talked about, has given the public access to the waterfront, and depends on how you define that definition. Everyone knows it works, and we can coexist with uses and product. I just want to give these comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That's very helpful. And John? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Is there somebody who wants to comment on Ms. Richardson's? Yes?
Okay.
Go ahead. Do you want to respond to that?
I don't want to respond directly to Linda's comments, but she brought it back to Janice's original question. And I heard more than one question in your comments, and I may have misheard, but I want to speak to the other question I heard, which was whether or not we should be putting additional money into further development or support of maritime activities. And I'm not sure if that's what you meant,
no,
but okay, because I just wanted to point out a number of things. Number one, everybody who talked about maritime activities alluded to the fact that there are thousands, and maybe every now and then as many as 100,000 people being employed within our maritime activity here in San Francisco. That translates into many, many blue-collar jobs. And blue-collar jobs have disappeared from San Francisco. There's nowhere else we can look to expect that we'll be able to continue to have the diverse population that makes up San Francisco if we don't have those blue-collar jobs. So that's number one. Number two, I'm a native San Franciscan. When I introduced myself before, I told you my mother was a Rosie the Riveter. My father was, he's retired Navy, okay? Maritime activities is in my blood, but it's in the blood of San Francisco, absolutely. It's in the DNA. If we didn't have this deep harbor, the fort would not have been built. That was the establishment of San Francisco. And when the gold rush occurred, San Francisco would not have bloomed because folks would have come, but they would have come somewhere else. And this city would not have been built up to what it is today. So it is truly imperative that we maintain the maritime activities, and not just in the southern waterfront, but across the whole waterfront, to maintain what San Francisco really is, to maintain those blue-collar jobs, to maintain the diversity that we have in San Francisco that we all really love. There are conflicts that occur. I was involved in deep conflict with the Bicycle Coalition because we were trying to make sure that the trucks had access down cargo way in and out of the southern waterfront. We worked all of that out. It is working somewhat. We're still hoping that will be revisited. But those things can be worked out. But the bottom line is people have to understand why maritime activities is truly important to the city of San Francisco.
Yeah, I just want to make a quick clarification. In no way, absolutely, especially being chair of this working group, would ever, ever make any kind of comment saying that there should be a decrease in maritime industry. I was just really wondering the specific interaction between maritime industry and the question of sea level rise, and really thinking about how our maritime industry will evolve because of things like sea level rise when we look at the future generations to come, as we have seen, as you know, Commissioner President Adams, Peter, you spoke to how the port has evolved over the past many generations. And so just really thinking about that specifically. But just wanted to clarify comments, and then I'll send it over to John.
And I mean, I would just add, we have a few of the 10 industries that are categorized as maritime, like excursion boats and ferries. But I mean, tourism relies on maritime, both for those examples, but I think a lot of our magnetism, people are drawn here because the waterfront's alive. It's not a dead waterfront, which you go to other countries and there's water, but it's really not part of the city. That's not true here. I wanted to go back to Carolyn Horgan's comment, because that's the only specific land use comment I've heard. I would love if there are other port tenants here tonight or during this process to let us know really specific examples. You know, that's an example of, you know, a pier that's got multiple tenants and one is under threat of being pushed out because it's competing against market rate tenants. I wondered if someone from the port could explain what, without getting too specific maybe on that situation. You know, I know Pier 19 and Pier 23, a little further up the waterfront, are both have been vacant or largely vacant of tenants since America's Cup sort of pushed out the tenants. What are we doing, if anything, to prioritize putting something maritime in some, if not all, of those places? Similarly, Pier 29, the bulkhead, just went out for bid for some tenant to go there. Is there anything we're doing to prioritize maritime?
Thank you, John. Who wants to take that?
Diane?
I defer to my commissioner.
Even your boss, particularly your boss.
Well, I'll try to address that. One of the things that we're doing is this process.
Why don't you identify yourself?
Oh, sorry, Byron Rhett. I'm the Deputy Director for Planning and Development of the Port. I mean, this process is a real key part of the answer to that question. We do want to focus both in the South Beach and the Northeast Waterfront on exactly how to reuse those facilities. Part of the reason that 19 and 23 are vacant is because we're not rushing in to fill them with tenants, that there's pressure to fill that continue the conflict that you're hearing from a couple of folks. We're wanting this process to help us sort of figure out what we should do there. I mean, it definitely is a challenge, but I think you'll see in the Southern Waterfront where we're a little clearer in what we're doing at Pier 70. We have prioritized ship repair. We've entered into a new 20-year lease to make sure that continues there. You saw the example with the Exploratorium. We negotiated that both we would have deep water berths and that the Bay Delta use would continue. We're making sure that the berthing will remain at 19 and 23 and at 29, and we're working with National Park Service to repair 31, to expand Alcatraz service there at 21, at 31, 33 and a half, and 33. And so those are some of the maritime uses that we're trying to work with. We're working with Blue and Gold and their existing facilities. And so what we're trying to do is create maritime anchors for all of these facilities so that you can have a facility very similar to Pier 1, where you have the port as a maritime anchor, and then you have other uses that help pay the rent, that help generate enough revenue to pay for substructure repair. And that's what we're trying to do at Pier 9. we would like to prioritize. I know as a tenant, it's a concern that maybe you'll be pushed out. We, just as we did with the Exploratorium going into 1517, we said that that tug and tow operation was a priority and must remain. We'll be doing the same thing with Blue and Gold and the other uses at Pier 9. And we hope as part of this planning process that you'll help us identify where we should be doing that at each one of these resources. So that when we put a Pier 29 or a Pier 19 or 23 out to bid, we can say, just as we did with 17, 15 with the Exploratorium, there must be a major maritime component. Or there is a maritime component that must remain and it must be incorporated in the new development. So we're hoping as we get into this discussion further with you all that we'll be able to make those decisions about 19, about 23, about 29, complementary uses to go with the, if we add uses to the cruise terminal at 35, that those will be uses that complement that operation there and that we'll reach agreement with Blue and Gold on expanding their services in Fisherman's Wharf.
Thank you. I'd like to give the young lady who's had a hand up for a long time now a chance to say something.
Thank you. I'm Pia Hinkle, and I'm on the advisory team, and I'm a bay swimmer. So I just wanted to sort of piggyback on some of the water-based potential conflicts and say a little bit about how open water swimming has grown as a sport, not just the historic clubs at Aquatic Park, but there's a lot of charity swims now, Alcatraz, the Golden Gate, so that's another area that it would be great to have the working group consider as, again, a water-dependent recreation, one-of-a-kind sort of activity, but that has potential for conflict with increased ferries, boats. So I'm glad to hear that the port is working to improve the Alcatraz berthing facilities for the ferry terminal and keeping them east of Hyde Street Pier, because a lot of swims take place west of Hyde Street Pier. So that's a big concern for the swimmers.
Thank you. Before we leave, I would like to, I'll be right there. I would like to make sure that those of you who are here representing port tenants and other users of the port who probably won't have another chance to have us all as your audience, that you use that opportunity, as John said. If you've got any other issues that you'd like to tell us about, this would be a good time to do so. So if any of you are here who have issues with land use issues that we ought to be hearing about, this would be a good time to do so. Please go ahead.
Yes. Mike Bishop with Lehigh Hanson. I'm the Marine Operations Manager for both the import facility at Pier 94, where we bring in sand and gravel from Canada, which has a capacity of about 100,000 metric tons of aggregates, and also our marine sand operation at Pier 92. And this supplies the concrete for basically constructing San Francisco. You go around a corner of Amador Street in Illinois, and I would estimate that 80 to 90% of all the concrete that goes into San Francisco goes around that corner. And the truck traffic that is at that intersection, 200-300 truck trips a day goes around that corner. Added to that, we've got a rail spur that comes in around that corner. And, you know, very nicely, the corner of 3rd and Cargo Way, we developed a very large park. A fairly hard structure, but it is bringing a lot of people down there. I've been in the area for 15, 16 years now, and the amount of public traffic, not runners and people coming down and visiting the area is a major conflict. Nothing that cannot be diffused, but it has to be, we have to keep this in mind. So the park is a big issue there. Up on Marin and Illinois, one of the buildings there started housing an art center of some sort or museum, you know, and it's just bringing people that are not used to this really dense truck traffic. And it brings traffic into the area, which then slows down the area. As Karen alluded to, Cesar Chavez, one of the main arteries out for all this truck traffic, has been a lane got taken out for bike traffic. You know, which I see a lot of more bikes going down there too. And you know, we've got another huge impact coming with the Warriors Stadium across from Pier 70. And once again, Pier 70 is inviting people to come down and appreciate the waterfront, which is very important, but we've got to keep moving our industry through these areas. And I'm very concerned that, you know, we've got to be able to keep this truck traffic moving through. It is what's building this city. And ironically, if we do have a major seismic event here, that Pier 92 and Pier 80 and Pier 94 and 96 are going to be where the construction materials come in and the debris goes out. So we have seen the squeeze from Mission Bay all the way down now to the southern waterfront, and we're getting squeezed. We're getting a lot of people who, as I said, don't know how to handle heavy construction assets. You know, and if you've been down Amador Street, down by the asphalt plant and the concrete plant, the road is just horrendous. I mean, and I'm quite happy that way. That way, cars don't drive down there. So it kills the truck drivers, but it sort of does help things. So that interface is becoming a tremendous problem.
Thank you. And some of those streets are under port jurisdictions and other are under city jurisdiction, I suppose. So you are fortunate in that you have a commissioner of the MTA who's here listening to this, so you have some of the issues you have are with MTA, and as I'm sure you know, and Ms. Repke is here. Yes, there's a gentleman back there who's been waving his hand for the last few times, so let me.
Make sure we get you a mic.
Fred Pecker with the International Longshore and Warehouse Union, the Warehouse Division. To just piggyback on some comments, to state the obvious, the maritime industry is going to do fine with sea level rise. It's the people who want to use the port as a playground who are going to have a problem, right? So I think that we really need to not worry so much about the people who are riding bikes down there and start worrying about how do we make sure that the infrastructure is there for industrial and maritime use. I wanted to say that in Oakland, they're ahead of us in terms of recognizing that the blue-collar jobs need to serve the community and make a way for people to stay in the city. And so both the city of Oakland and the port of Oakland now, as it's moving forward on the West Oakland Army Base development, have recognized that community benefit agreements are critical in terms of making sure that we maintain a stable community and that the jobs that come in are made available to the workers and non-workers, but the future workers in the city of San Francisco. And every port that the ILWU is in, we know there's a need for a buffer zone between recreational uses and industrial uses. And unfortunately, the recreational uses get a lot better press because they're a lot nicer to look at than forklifts moving and trucks moving. But as we just heard, those trucks moving are what makes the commerce happen in the city.
Thank you. Okay, gentlemen there. Yes.
Hi, Dilip Trivedi. I'm one of the working group members,
yes,
and representing, I think, along with some others, the resiliency aspect. So it's a great question that Janice threw out. But I'd like to just start off and just comment in all the presentations in every one of these. I wasn't in the last one, but the videotapes have really helped So the presentations have been A grade, so we've just learned quite a bit. There's two things I wanted to start with, just making an observation and then a question to Diane and some of the other staff in terms of your expectation from working group. Over the next couple of decades with sea level rise, I think there's, I mean, everyone knows that there's really going to be only one place along San Francisco where sea level rise adaptations are going to have to occur for the city. And so the purview of what we are doing goes beyond port jurisdictions and port lands and extends all the way out to the city. So that was one. And the other one is the conflicts between the maritime uses and potential for adapting to sea level rise. So how macro, if you will, would you like us to go in terms of understanding that port properties are probably going to be where adaptations are going to have to occur? And how micro would you like us to go in terms of the regional context of maritime uses? Because it's quite possible that if the Embarcadero is raised, many of the maritime uses become very difficult to operate trucks going out of the piers, you know, 5 feet on an Embarcadero, which is higher. So is there an aspect of coalescing the maritime uses in regional areas, leveraging dollars that are coming from conflicting uses, like Carolyn mentioned, all in the context of a waterfront that is about 80 years old in terms of its age, and so the infrastructure, the seawall we already know, the piers, the FEMA floodplains. So.
I don't know that we're going to be able to answer that with any great specificity, but if Brad wants to try, have at it.
And Linda is just prompting me here to also just mention that the Treasure Island project that Linda mentioned, you know, is right. Something that really has received a lot of acclaim in terms of a methodology to address it. And again, I've been fortunate to work on that.
Yeah, as Brad responds to that, and it's a very good question, the issue of how deep we're going to go into any one remedy or any one issue and the level of specificity with which we address those, I don't have an answer for that because, frankly, I don't know myself at the moment. That will evolve, one hopes. But the more specific questions, Brad, maybe you can answer.
And you know, I think this keeps on coming up tonight, and I think it shows that everybody's curious about what this means for the port. It sort of is a defining issue, and I think we'll drill into this a little bit more when we get to the resiliency conversation. Stephen Reel, the project manager for the seawall, I think will give you a lot of food for thought about this. And I think what you're raising, Dilip, is, you know, how does the city protect itself? And that really is this conversation that the planning department and the public works department have been engaging. And I think you're going to see a lot more coming from them on this. And I just want you all to know that the city really is grappling with this question. So I'll leave it at that.
And the port is involved in these conversations.
The port is involved in these conversations.
Yes. Byron?
I just wanted to add to that with some examples of things that we are sort of taking on, where it's easier to address some of these issues. So south of the ballpark, with a Giants development at Seawall Lot 337, or as they call it, Mission Rock, or at Pier 70, the Four Cities Waterfront development, because we're not talking about finger piers there, those developments will be raising the land mass 3, 4, 5 feet to address sea level rise. It'll be easier to do there. It's a bigger challenge for finger piers in this area where we are. There are ways to address it, and Stephen Reel, as we get into some of these discussions, we'll be able to talk some about that, solidifying some of these rails, you know, things that we can do to deal with 1 or 2 or 3 feet in the near term, as we talk more of that, then it's a bigger challenge. But I also wanted to reference something that we're doing at Pier 70 and Amador to address some of the issues that were just touched on. So we're trying to make 20th Street at Pier 70 more pedestrian friendly but there's a lot of truck traffic for the BAE operations there. So as part of David Belpre is here, but he is leading the design and construction of Crane Cove Park, which is in the northern portion of Pier 70. As part of that, we're building a new 19th Street into Pier 70, and that 19th Street will become the truck access for BAE, and we'll get their trucks off 20th Street. You heard Restoration Hardware is one of the tenants going into Building 101 at 20th and Illinois. So we will build, with a park will start construction this year. We'll have the new 19th Street in. We'll be able to shift all that truck traffic to 19th Street, and they'll have a street that'll work for them. And then we can have the pedestrian access that takes you down to the waterfront there. The Port Commission heard its proposed, the staff's proposed budget. They'll consider it for vote on February 23rd. But the rebuilding, the beginning of the rebuilding of Amador was in that two-year budget. We'll be redoing the subway, the sewer lines first, and then hopefully working with DPW to rebuild the entire street because, as Mike said, it's a deterrent for all of us to drive down, but it's very difficult even for big trucks to drive down that street. So we need, that is a port street. But we'll be trying to partner with DPW. If we can build it to city standards, we hope that DPW will then take on the ongoing maintenance of that street. But that work will start probably next fiscal year, 16-17 fiscal year.
Thank you. One last question. Yes, sir. You're it.
Tom Radulovich. I'm with BART, and I wanted to ask a follow-up question on that regional perspective, as I know from transit agencies, when we're all working together, when we're planning together, and there's two dozen in the Bay Area, it works better for the public, and we don't waste public resources. So we need to work and plan together. There's eight ports in the Bay Area, and so, you know, all of you are using waterfront land, all of you are going to be using public resources to build facilities and raise facilities and do all these things. So I'm wondering, how do you coordinate? How do you make sure that, you know, you're serving the public well and you're not engaging in destructive competition with one another, but you are meeting the reasonably anticipated needs of to move goods around the region?
Tom is modest in saying he's with BART. He's a member of the board of directors of BART, which is more than being with. and a quick answer to Mr. Radulovich.
Quick answer. We do compete, but as I tried to explain, we are definitely in different segments of the business. Again, we're a bulk operator. Oakland doesn't do bulk. But in terms of communication and coordination, they're all California ports. There's a California Association of Port Authorities. We meet on a monthly basis. We tackle, like in Southern California and in Northern California, but in Southern California, the ports of LA and Long Beach were in terms with the Southern California Air Quality Board, work together to implement these new air quality standards. So I think 25 years ago, it was dog eat dog, and everybody was trying to get what they could get. Today, there's much more rationalization and coordination. And I think federal grants, Tiger transportation infrastructure grants from the federal government, require coordination and partnerships with other regions and other ports.
Have a single plan? I mean, I know in the Bay Area we have a regional transportation plan. It's all 26 operators. Is there a port plan that's regional?
The state of California has for the first time ever, and Commissioner Adams knows, up in Canada they have a federal freight plan. Up in Washington State they have a Washington. The ports of Tacoma and Seattle essentially have merged their container operations. California finally has a California the beginnings of a California freight coordination plan that's going to be run through Sacramento. So to answer your question, yes, but stay tuned. Okay. It's new.
Okay. Is it done or is it?
It's just started.
Okay. Thank you. We are really at the end, but somebody tells me, somebody back there whom I cannot see has been trying to ask a question. Is there somebody back?
Joe.
Are you it? Okay. Yes,
sorry.
Sir. Please.
I really apologize for keeping everybody past time. I want to be leaving too. Okay. My name is Joe Burgard. I'm the Vice President of Operations from the Red and White Fleet. There were a number of questions that were addressed to port tenants. We're one of the tenants.
Yes.
We've been around not since 1862, but 1892. We had the good fortune of experience continued growth, and we are looking to renew our port lease, and we're also doing some capital investments in doing that. The reason why I stood up to talk is this issue of seawater rise, and everybody in this room seems to support the notion that we need to protect our investments, and it's a real challenge to talk to people outside of this community about things like wave attenuation, how to put structures in to preserve waterfront investments. So I just wanted to say that as a port tenant, this is one of the issues that we're confronting. One last other one is land use. Our customers stand along the waterfront, and there's oftentimes seems to be a conflict between, if you bought a ticket, are you still public? Is that public access or is it not? And I just bring it up as one of the topics as we look forward to developing our small corner of the waterfront. Thank you.
Thank you, and I'm sorry I made you wait so long. If you'd been here, I would have seen you. Okay, thank you all. And next time we meet is going to be on finances. And for the purpose of the staff, I hope that really means the capital plan, which is what we really, I think, want to emphasize on. Yeah, operating a little bit, capital plan a lot.
But this presentation was a lot more fun than that one's going to be.
Okay, thank you all, and good night.
SFGovTV, San Francisco Government Television.